Well, good morning, everyone. With our booming economy, Americans and their families are better off. Remember, now some said tax reform was going to be Armageddon. But after years of sluggish growth, a stagnant economy, bigger paychecks, more take-home pay, more jobs, it is a totally different world, and it's not the end of the world. We were told by the left that it would be bad for women. When you look at last month's jobs report, it was women returning to the workforce that helped drive those numbers. They said it would be bad for individuals with disabilities. And again, you're seeing those with disabilities enter into the workforce at a record rate. We heard that wage increases and bonuses were crumbs and pathetic for middle-class families. Well, more money in your bank account. We see consumer confidence at a record high. The left's scare tactics and out-of-touch rhetoric has not matched reality. On better.gop, you can get all the facts. You can see the results. People's lives are improving because of our pro-growth, our pro-family agenda. So while the Democrats may want to look back to the days of 9.9% unemployment and promote unpopular ideas like raising taxes, the People's House is going to stay hard at work. This week, we're continuing to lead on solutions that are going to strengthen our communities. We're going to be sending legislation to the president's desk that will provide pro bono legal services for those that are involved in sexual and domestic violence. We will also advance critical funding to combat the catastrophic wildfires and continue our work to repeal Obama-era regulations that will help further grow our economy. With us today is Representative Mia Love. She's a dynamic leader from Utah's 4th District. She serves on the Financial Services Committee, and they have been taking the lead on Jobs 3.0 and promoting the impact that it is having also on our growing economy. So thank you, Mia, for your work. Glad you're here.
Thank you. Thank you. I am very pleased to be here today to help spread the word about how Americans and Utahns in my district are better off now. Thanks to our pro-growth policies, we have led our economy to an upswing. If you don't believe me, ask people in Utah. Ask the mothers and fathers that are struggling and doing everything that they possibly can to make ends meet. Today, Utah's economy is booming with one of the lowest unemployment rates in the nation. In fact, due to our better off policies, our state has added over 50,000 jobs over the past year. My neighbors are telling me that the new tax law is allowing them to keep a little bit more of their money that they earn. Tax reform is helping small businesses. They are the lifeblood of our communities. And we're not stopping there. Today, the House will vote on a package of capital formation bills that will create more jobs and help new businesses get off the ground. It's expected to pass with strong bipartisan support. So keep an eye out for Jobs 3.0 Act, a product of the Financial Services Committee, which I am more than proud to serve on. We support our economy's long-term growth to ensure that Americans are better off now and in the future. Thank you.
Great work, Mia. It's exciting to see the great economic news that continues to happen because of the tax cuts that we passed, and families are recognizing that they are better off now. When you look at the new retail sales numbers, especially driven by Americans buying new cars and buying used cars to finally be able to have better vehicles to get around to their new jobs. And you're seeing millions of people finally that gave up looking for work that are finally getting back into the workforce and are now going into maybe their first job, or job that might give them an opportunity to buy their first home. So Americans are better off now, and you're seeing the real results. More good news keeps coming, and we're going to keep working with Jobs 3.0 that we're passing this week to make it even easier for people to have a piece of the American dream. We're doing a lot of other things this week to address the problems facing this country. And as we've seen, as crime and opioids especially continue to infiltrate this country, we're bringing a resolution to stand up for our ICE agents. And while the Democrats are talking about getting rid of the very people that keep our country safe, that get rid of people that are here that are criminals, you know, if you look at ICE, last year over 100,000 people that came here illegally with criminal backgrounds were removed by ICE agents, keeping our country safer. That's who Nancy Pelosi and her liberal allies want to get rid of, those very agents, men and women, law enforcement officers that are protecting this country, keeping opioids out of this country, stopping human trafficking, keeping terrorists that try to enter our country illegally from coming in when they get into the interior of our country. That's who we're standing up for with this resolution by my colleague from Louisiana, Clay Higgins, and that's the very people that the Democrats are talking right now about getting rid of. I think it shows an important contrast in this country about what's at stake in this November election. We stand up for our ICE agents and the people that are keeping America safe. They want to get rid of them. It's a radical idea they have, and this resolution is really important. And there's another important resolution, the resolution to block a carbon tax, to oppose a carbon tax. There's still people talking about trying to impose a carbon tax, which would be devastating to our manufacturing economy. One of the great bright spots we see in our economy, where we're bringing jobs back to America, rebuilding our middle class, a carbon tax would destroy that. So we're going to have everybody go on record with a resolution to oppose a carbon tax. And then finally, we're bringing two more important appropriations bills as we've continued to move bills through the process to rebuild our military with the DOD probes bill we've already passed. Three bills that are now in a conference committee on appropriations. We have two more, the Financial Services Appropriations Bill and the Interior Appropriations Bill, that have real important policies. Repealing Waters of the U.S., another radical Obama-era regulation that is killing jobs and making it harder for Americans to develop their own private property. Let's restore property rights. Let's repeal WOTUS. That's in this. We also have Tom Graves' provision that creates the Fund for America's Kids and Grandkids, something that's really important to start reducing the deficit in this country. That's in this bill, too. So looking forward to a strong vote.
Good morning. Every day we see new numbers of the economy being stronger. That means more people working, more opportunities for the future. If you just watched the last report where you watched 600,000 more Americans entered the workforce, they were outside of the workforce and they came back in. Then we just found the two new reports where the U.S. retail sales up 0.5% in June. That's 6.6% from June of 2017. Another example of the growth we have seen since the passage of our tax cut bill. More U.S. businesses, economists expect corporate sales to grow over the next 3 months and hiring pay to rise with them as well. The paychecks are rising. You'll be able to take more home, more than 1 million new jobs, unemployment at one of the lowest levels. This is an economy we want to continue to build on. That's why when you look to the floor, Jobs 3.0, I was one of the authors of 1.0 in 2012. And what it was about was the formation of capital and entrepreneurship. So those young companies, those young individuals that have ever thought about opening a business have the opportunity to have the capital to do it. And those small businesses become big businesses. It's a unique opportunity, but a very important bill. And you'll find a very big vote that we make sure that that becomes law. I want to thank Mia Love for her work and also Jeb Hensarling, the chairman, for his work on this. One other point I wanted to bring up that we watched. The Democrats continue talking about removing ICE. They introduced a bill. They co-sponsored it. But the hypocrisy of it, that they said if you were given the opportunity in the minority to actually bring their bill up, that they want to vote against it. ICE last year arrested 2,000 people for human trafficking. More than 900,000 pounds of narcotics. 172 people will die today because of an addiction. You watched more than 50 bills that we passed become law, that we want to pass to become law, that we have sitting in the Senate, to battle opioids. Fentanyl, one of the most deadliest elements of a drug coming across, comes across our border. ICE is the first line of defense. MS-13 gangs, stopping them from coming to our community. Well, you know what? We're going to have a vote on the floor. Clay Higgins has a bill, lays out what ICE has been doing to keep our community safe and our country. It also denounces this action to eliminate and abolish ICE. So there's an opportunity. Your base may say you want to have it. You may introduce a bill to think that you support it. I want to see where people really stand on it, because it is too important for the safety of our community that we maintain ICE and the work that they are doing. other elements that you'll find that we continue to work through the appropriations process. We're already into a conference. We'll also vote to go to conference on the Farm Bill, continuing to get the work done that the American people asked for and continuing to make America grow and more opportunities for the future generation.
Morning. I recently had the chance to visit a couple manufacturers up in Minneapolis, St. Paul. And the story there is very similar to what we are seeing all around the country. More people are finding work. Companies are expanding. Confidence is surging. Our policies have helped create this climate. This is a climate of growth. The American people are better off now, and we need to keep it going. This week, we'll consider legislation to make it easier for small companies to access the capital markets. It's a key source of financing. This is where most new jobs come from, new companies. It will cut down on regulations that are holding back small businesses and startups. It's the third piece in a line of critical bipartisan bills aimed at creating jobs, unlocking innovation, and driving growth. This will help us sustain the positive growth that we are already seeing. And this all gets us back to creating an environment where entrepreneurs can succeed and workers can get ahead. I want to commend Chairman Jeb Hensarling, and I want to commend Mia Love from the Financial Services Committee for their efforts in bringing this really critical bipartisan legislation to the floor. One thing I heard about in the Twin Cities is the need for more workers, and especially workers with the right skills. This is a new sort of good problem that we have these days. We have jobs, but we need workers with skills to fill those jobs. Soon, we will be taking the next step on the Farm Bill. Our version would retool the SNAP program to focus on encouraging recipients to enter the workforce. This is a model that we should be moving to, helping more Americans reach their potential, moving from welfare to work, getting on the ladder of life. In this economy, there is no better time to do this. Just go to better.gop to learn more. Questions? Well, let me be really clear. Let me try and be as clear as I can to the world of the country. We stand by our NATO allies and all those countries who are facing Russia aggression. How many times have I stood up here and told you what I think about Vladimir Putin? Vladimir Putin does not share our interests. Vladimir Putin does not share our values. We just conducted a year-long investigation into Russia's interference in our elections. They did interfere in our elections. It's really clear. There should be no doubt about that. It's also clear that it didn't have a material effect on our elections. But as a result of that, we passed tough sanctions on Russia so that we can hold them accountable. I understand the desire and the need to have good relations. That's perfectly reasonable. But Russia is a menacing government that does not share our interests and it does not share our values. And I think that should be made very, very clear. Sherman.
What could you do? I mean, you guys are a co-equal branch of government. What could you do to make sure that he doesn't do something?
Here's what we have already done, and here's what we could continue to do, which is to put sanctions on Russia. You just saw the indictments from the special counsel. Those GRU officers, I've already seen the intelligence. They were the people that conducted this cyber attack on our elections. We'd already put in place sanctions. If the Foreign Affairs Committee or the Financial Services Committee and the Senate Banking Committee think that there are other sanctions that we have not yet placed upon Russia, I'm more than happy to consider those. Yeah.
Me?
Yeah, who are you with?
Bobby Greenspan with CNS News. So Speaker Ryan, Obama's CIA Director John Brennan, said that President Trump's press conference in—
You said Oklahoma's, excuse me?
I'm sorry?
CNS News.
Yeah.
CNS
News. No, yeah, go ahead.
Obama's. CIA Director John Brennan said that President Trump's press conference in Helsinki, quote, rises to and exceeds the threshold of high crimes and misdemeanors, unquote, and, quote, was nothing short of treasonous, unquote. Do you agree with Brennan that Trump's actions were treasonous?
I do not. Manu.
Speaker, you talked about your year-long investigation that happened in the House Intelligence Committee. In that report, it disputed the finding of the intelligence community's assessment that Vladimir Putin wanted Trump to win. Yet yesterday, Vladimir Putin said he wanted Trump to win.
Yeah.
I'll
refer you to the Intelligence Committee. What they were concerned about was the tradecraft that was conducted by our Intelligence Committee. And when we reviewed the IC, we also believe that there were some mistakes made by the IC. But let's be very clear, just so everybody knows, Russia did meddle with our elections. Not only did Russia meddle in our elections, they're doing it around the world. They did it to France. They did it to Moldova. They're doing it to the Baltics. Russia is trying to undermine democracy itself, to delegitimize democracy. So for some reason, they can look good by comparison. Let's just be really clear about that. And the point we are making here is we know they interfere with our elections, and we have passed sanctions on Russia to hold them accountable. And more importantly, what we intend to do is to make sure that they don't get away with it again, and also to help our allies, to help those democracies, those new and older democracies in the world who are going to be facing this kind of Russia again, this Russia aggression again. We need to make sure that we can equip them with the tools they need to stop this from happening in their democracies. Deirdre. I have not spoken to him. I put out a statement yesterday within minutes after that press conference, and I think that statement speaks for itself.
Speaker Ryan, in light of the new indictments on Friday and the president's comments yesterday, does any of that change your view about perhaps Congress doing something to protect Special Counsel Mueller so he can continue his work, or encouraging some of your colleagues to back off their attacks on the Department of Justice?
Well, look, we've had compliance issues with the Department of Justice. That just goes to the legislative branch conducting oversight of the executive branch. Those compliance issues, unfortunately, I had to get involved. It shouldn't have to take a speaker to get involved in that. But they are now coming to compliance. We're trying to close out those items. So that's an important point, which is they were not complying with our subpoenas, and we're now making sure that they do comply with our subpoenas. On the Mueller issue, I've been clear from day one. He should be allowed to finish his investigation and carry out his work. Nothing's changed. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Questions.